And so with no deal achieved and without a firm agreement to meet again, what are the prospects for ending a civil war that's claimed an estimated 130,000 lives and displaced millions? We turn once again to Joshua Landis, director of the Center for Middle Eastern Studies at the University of Oklahoma, and Andrew Tabler, a senior fellow in the program on Arab politics at the Washington Institute for Near East Policy. Joshua Landis, let me start with you. What do you take from this first round of talks?
Well, I think many people were expecting that the United States would be willing to take half a loaf, that it would be willing to compromise to the point of not asking for regime change in Syria in order to get perhaps some access to starving people, to victims inside Syria, and perhaps the beginnings of a ceasefire in order to alleviate the suffering of the Syrians and the big outflow of refugees that risks to bring down and trouble neighboring states. But the U.S. stuck to its guns and said that there has to be regime change in Syria. As soon as the Assad regime sensed this and heard the opening speech, it began to take away offers of ceasefire, access to humanitarian agencies, and the conversation became one of accusation, counter-accusation, very heated. And we haven't seen any progress, and we've seen stalling on chemical weapons. I think that the regime went to Geneva, the Syrian regime, believing that it could, that the United States was beginning to get worried about the jihadist problem and would strike a deal somehow with the Assad regime. And that did not happen.
All right, Andrew, what do you take from it? And you know, the very fact of meeting, even symbolically, does that have any importance?
Yes, it does. That it got the diplomatic ball rolling. Many people predicted that the opposition would collapse. That didn't happen. They didn't end up with getting access. The reason why I think the U.S. stuck to its guns is because this conference was about transition. It was never going to be about a conference about why the Assad regime should be doing what it's obligated to do under international humanitarian law and the Geneva Convention. Access of humanitarian goods and evacuation of civilians are required there. It's about a transition. Russia's on board with that. Actually, at the end of the week, I think the opposition gets a tactical victory, at least in the short term.
But in addition to transition, there are this humanitarian crisis going on. We mentioned homes, for example. What's the holdup there with getting something?
The regime will not allow supplies through their lines into Homs. Now, in Homs, the rebels there are actually more reliable. There's better command and control. The long siege there has pushed them together. They're also better connected with the Syrian National Coalition. So it was a golden opportunity. Unfortunately, it was missed, and we'll have to see if the regime comes back to the negotiating table on February 10th.
Joshua Landis, are things like the humanitarian crisis? Is that on the table there? Was it make any headway?
It didn't make any headway. It was on the table, but the regime was trying to make a deal, and it didn't sense that there was a deal, and so it took its offer of aid off the table. And we're back to a war of attrition here. And I've talked to a number of people in Washington and Paris about this, and they feel that Assad is at his acme, his greatest, strongest point here, because he's had a number of successes militarily. The rebels are in chaos. But they believe that with time, the rebels will get a new command structure that they're getting together. They're going to get more help. And that the minority regime behind Assad, the Alawites, Christians, other minorities, are only about the 20% of the Syrian population. They can be attrited, and their young men will be killed off eventually. And that in a year's time, or perhaps even two, the balance of power will be very different. And this regime will begin to collapse, and then the conversation will change.
Andrew Tabler, what about the reports that Syria is so far behind on the timetable to give up its poison gas stocks?
Right. It's only handed over about 4% of the initial shipment of 500 tons. But not only that, Syria is now refusing to physically destroy its chemical weapons facilities. Instead, they want to make it inaccessible, mm-hmm. Meaning like lock up the front doors, weld it, which is easily reversed. The U.S. has come out very strongly. And remember that the Geneva communique on which the talks have been going on there, the only place it's enshrined inside the United Nations is in the U.N. Security Council 2118 that deals with the chemical weapons issue. So they're actually linked in there. And so I think now we're going to be going back to the Security Council concerning chemical weapons and as a humanitarian access.
Is this tied to what Joshua Landis was talking about, that Assad feeling himself still very powerful?
Assad feels himself very powerful, particularly in the western part of the country. But what's interesting is Assad, despite being so powerful, is saying, I'm not strong enough to allow these convoys of these chemical weapons and these chemical agents through the Kalamun area out to the coast. He's demanding more and more equipment, and he did which is interesting. If he's so strong in the west, why demand so much equipment? Actually, the international community believes they've provided sufficient equipment, so does the OPCW, and that led to the statements we've seen from the United States the last few days.
Well, so Joshua Landis, do you expect the Syrian government to go back to the table on February 10th? Are there some areas, even limited, where there might be some progress?
I don't think they want to talk about regime change. And, you know, the message from Geneva was the most important thing is that Assad has to step down. We need regime change in Syria. Assad's not going to step down. And, you know, this is going to be done over his dead body. And this is what this civil war is about. And that's where we are once again. He thought there was an opening for that the West was falling out of love with the Syrian opposition. They're worried about the jihadists. They're willing to talk about Assad remaining. As you remember, you know, the ex-head of CIA, Hayden, had said, well, maybe Assad is better than the opposition. And Ryan Crocker, important ambassador and spokesperson for the State Department, now retired, had said the same thing, roughly, that he expects Assad to win. So Assad, I think, had begun to feel that perhaps there was a changing mood in the West. He discovered in Geneva there is no change in the West. Kerry was very dramatic. This is about regime change. He said that Assad is the reason for the jihadists there. He is the magnet. And until he goes, jihadists will not go.
Okay.
And that was his assertion.
All right, let me add you very briefly, Andrew. Are you as pessimistic?
I'm pessimistic in terms of relieving the suffering on the ground. But I think it's no mistake President Obama talked about Syria three times in his State of the Union speech. He talked about, surprisingly, about supporting the moderate rebels. Dealing with extremism in Syria isn't just as simple as slipping back to the Assad regime. It has to involve working with the opposition as well, particularly the moderate parts of it that we can deal with.
All right, Andrew Tabler, Joshua Landis, thanks again.
Pleasure.